Financial Planner Flowbot on YouTube.
North Korea can withstand an embargo? Is the cabal finished? Let's get into the economic collapse, political and geopolitical news. Now, Mueller is pushing his investigation, and he wants to start interviewing the six members of Trump's inner circle. And these are certain individuals like Sean Spicer, Rince Priebus, and the rest of them. And he's looking to find out some information. And basically, he wants to find out information about James Comey's firing. Now, they're just going all over the place looking to find out, you know, anything they possibly can. They're looking at financial records. They're looking pretty much at everything. Really, what we're seeing right now is they really can't find anything about this Russian collusion. And that's why Mueller is actually there, where he's looking to find information about Russian collusion. And he's looking in all different directions, trying to find things. And at this point, there is really nothing there. And this is why he's scrambling to talk to other individuals, see what they have. And what we're seeing is that all this stuff, it is just completely falling apart. And eventually what's going to happen is that he'll find nothing. There'll be a report. It'll be put out there. And there'll be nothing about this Russian collusion, because as we know from Veritas, Project Veritas, when they went undercover, all these individuals said, yeah, this Russian collusion thing completely, it is made up, it is a nothing burger, and there is nothing to be found from this. Now, we see there was another data hack, and this was with Equifax, and they've confessed that, yes, that some of the stolen data is name, social security number, birth dates, some credit card information. And they're saying about 209,000 credit card numbers were accessed. And we could see at this point, and we need to understand, why is this all happening? Well, we have to remember that the CIA, from all their tools, from Vault 7, they've left back doors. And when you have a back door where you can access the information, you know, they've modified computer systems, they modified chips, they place software in the operating systems, and when you do this and you leave back doors, hackers will find these back doors and they will use them, because the companies and those tech teams, they don't realize that these do exist. They think they're securing everything. And I remember when I was working for a major banking system where you had no clue that something was embedded in a chip or there was a malware sitting there, because you can do a scan, and if the CIA has control over all of this, the scan will not show you anything, especially if something is embedded in a chip. It will definitely not pick it up. And we can see at this point that as they've been opening up back doors all over to these all these different systems, you're going to see more of these type of hacks. And who is responsible? Well, the CIA. We see the U.S. wants the U.N. to vote on sanctions, and they're looking to do this on Monday. And basically what they want to do with China, with South Korea, they want some type of oil embargo. They want an embargo on North Korea. But what's very interesting about this embargo is it's not going to really work, because North Korea, over the many, many years, they have basically preparing their entire country to be self-sufficient. And a report is out there saying that a full-scale oil embargo against North Korea is unlikely, and it will unlikely work, because North Korea, they have a huge amount of oil reserves, and they've been building this up over time with many other supplies to be self-sufficient. And in addition to the large reserves of domestic coal and the increased reliance on green energy in the form of hydroelectric power, North Korea's domestic oil reserves are likely far greater than previous conservative estimates have indicated. So all this talk about placing these embargoes most likely will not have an effect on North Korea whatsoever. Now, of course, the corporate media and everyone else wants you to believe that this will have an effect, but I don't think so at this point. And placing more sanction on countries, it really doesn't work, because they always find a way around this. And we can see from Cuba, from Syria to Iran, where they had sanctions on them for many, many years. Guess what? They survived. It doesn't work. Now, China, they are lodging a protest with South Korea over the deployment of THAAD launchers. And we know why the THAAD launchers are being brought into South Korea. It has nothing to do with North Korea. This has to do with the buildup of military assets in South Korea, pointing it to China and Russia. Because eventually what they really wanted to do, and this is going back a little bit in time, is they wanted to have a war with China and Russia. This was the plan, to bring us to a war, to cover up this economic collapse. But as we can see, this is all really falling apart. Because what do we see happening here? Whatever they're doing with North Korea right now, trying to provoke North Korea, it is not working. They're not going to stop their missile program. They're not going to stop their nuclear program. Sanctions aren't going to work. Embargo is not going to work. The cabal is pretty much finished right now. Unless they have some type of major event right now where they blow this thing wide open, which they still might do. We're still looking at this. We can see that they haven't given up. Unless they do something like this, they're done. They're finished. There's nothing left for them to do. We see the U.S., they approved arms sales worth over $3.8 billion to Bahrain. And we can see right now the package of the weapons include F-16 fighters, upgrade to missiles, patrol boats. And we can see that they are still selling weapons to all these countries that have human rights violations. And the United States has been doing this for quite a while. We see U.N. troops, they're going to arrive in Libya now. They're bringing in about 250 U.N. troops. They will arrive there, and they expect to carry out activities, and of course, they're not letting anyone know what these activities are, and most likely, it's to protect the UN-backed government that they put into place in Libya, because what we see happening right now, the people don't want a government that was picked for them. They want to elect a government, and this is why there's a huge amount of problem in Libya. Now, remember, Trump has said that we're not getting involved in Libya. And we can see out in Iraq and many other countries, a lot of these countries are working, especially General Haftar in Libya is working with Russia. Iraq is working with Iran and Russia. We see Syria working with Russia. And we can see that all of these Middle Eastern countries, they're turning away from the United States. They don't want the puppet regimes. And everything is starting to fall apart. Now, it has been confirmed right now, and it's pretty much 100% true, that the United States, the cabal, they were evacuating the Islamic State leaders. Now, Russia is out there, and they're saying, listen, we have evidence of this, and Trump should investigate why this is happening. Who is airlifting these paid mercenaries, these terrorists, out of the country? Now, let's see what Trump does at this point, because he should investigate. Why is the United States helping paid mercenaries, terrorists, to escape from Syria when they told us they were the bad guys? Well, we know, we've been talking about it for a very long time. We know the United States, the cabal, supported and created these paid mercenaries. And I think at this point, the United States needs to look into this and see exactly who is involved in this. We see that the Syrian army has begun their Operation Assad Leap. It looks like they're going into the Deir Ezor airport. This is a military airport, and it looks like they're having this major offensive to free the military airport. And I don't think they're going to actually have a problem. I think they're going to be able to do it with absolutely no problem, because what we see happening in Syria is that the Syrian forces, they are clearing out the area completely. The Red Cross is out in Syria saying, listen, the Russian-Syrian de-escalation zones, they are working. Violence is way, way down, and people feel safe. They are returning to Syria. The refugees are coming back now. Hundreds of thousands of people are coming back, and they're saying that these zones are actually working because they have the military police. They're protecting these people, and it is safe. Now, this is completely opposite of what the United States wanted to do, and I'm talking about the cabal. They wanted these no-fly zones, which they kept changing the name, you know, safe zones, no-fly zones, where they wanted to destroy all the planes of the Syrian army, just like they did in Libya, to make sure that there's no-fly zones around the area. These are de-escalation zones where the people are safe in these areas, where they keep out the terrorists and they set up a perimeter to make sure that none of these terrorists are able to get in there and get back into these areas and hurt the families, the women, the children, the men. And we see that this is actually working, and the Red Cross is saying that yes, this does work. We see that Russia, the United States, and Jordan, they've reached an agreement which will allow the Syrian army to take control of virtually all militant held southern Syria on the border of Jordan, and they're taking, I think, something like control over 900 key points. There's only one area which they're not going to control, is the TANF base with Iraq. But we can see right now that Syria, Russia, they are controlling their borders. The Islamic State, they are doomed. They're stuck in the middle of Syria. There is no way out. Supplies are not coming in. And we see at this point, the cabal is finished in this area. It's just a matter of months where Syria and Russia is going to take complete control of the entire country. The United States will be forced out. The coalition forces will be forced out. They'll take full control of their borders. And the cabal, their dream of a pipeline going through Syria, taking control of Syria, then going into Iran, well, this has come to an end. So what does the cabal have left? They have Venezuela, and we see Venezuela, they're going to get around the sanctions because they're going to bypass the dollar, and this is going to be a huge problem. And we see North Korea. Now, the only thing they can do at this point is to create some type of major event, and they are running out of time because if there's some type of diplomatic solution in North Korea, guess what? They are done for. If Russia and China are able to formulate some type of agreement, the cabal is completely finished. And there'll be nothing left for them to do. Yes, can they have some type of major event? Well, it looks like this still could happen, where they say maybe North Korea cyber attacked the United States. But once that diplomatic agreement is made, I don't know how they're going to pull this off. So if we get close to a diplomatic solution, we know that the cabal, they're going to pull out all the stops and have some type of an event because they really have nothing left. So this is exactly what we're watching now, to see exactly what they do. Remember, the economy is falling apart now. Countries are bypassing the dollar. They're running out of time. Time is ticking down right now. And the economy is deteriorating. And as we move into this fall, into this holiday season, it's just going to get worse. It's not going to improve. And they can't wait too long, because if they do, guess who gets blamed? The central bank. And they don't want to be blamed, because they want to restart the system. So this is what we're watching right now. The clock is ticking down. And we can see they don't have many options left.